Hey everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Hi, this is Candy Zappa. I'm Frank Zappa's little sister.
Hi, this is Bob Harris, former Frank Zappa band member.
Hi, folks. This is Robert Bobby Martin from Frank Zappa's band, 81 through 88.
Hi, grown-up boys and girls. I'm Sandro Liva, and I was the Italian of the group with the Grandmothers in the 90s.
Hi, this is Arthur Barrow, a.k.a. the Clone Meister for the Frank Zappa Band, as well as his bass player.
Hey, this is Lisa Popeil.
Hi, this is Susanna Harris, former vocalist for Frank Zappa.
This is Billy Hulping from Zappa Plays Zappa.
This is Ike Willis, and we're talking Zappa on Uncle Tony's station here. Please, everybody listen. I had a great time, and so will you.
Hi, boys and girls. This is Don Preston. You're listening to Talking Zappa, and you should all listen to this show because it's fantastic.
You should all listen to this show because it's fantastic. That's right. See, I didn't say that. Don said it. Hey, everybody, it's Talking Zappa with Tony Trombo, me. And let's see. This is my YouTube conversion. Let's see, I'm taking all my shows, putting them on YouTube. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. And I tell you why, because when I post these new ones up, you will get a little notification. And then you'll be able to listen. Or not. But you'll... At least you'll have the chance to listen. And also, TonyTrombo.com, T-O-N-Y-T-R-O-M-B-O, and .com. Yeah, you can go there and check out stuff. And I've got, you know, I've done film work and books and music stuff. And I got so much stuff. And you can see it and check it out and do whatever you want to do and dance to it. And have a good time with the Bebop Tango. Speaking of... I don't know what I was speaking of, but this show, ladies and gentlemen, Ed Mann. Now, you know who Ed is. He was percussionist with Frank for a long time, and I got him on the phone. And, of course, you know, I've been doing the percussion thing for a lot of years, too. So this was very interesting to talk to somebody who makes money at it, because I never made a penny at it. I lost money on that deal, buying stuff. Of course, that's with most everything I... Everything. I lose money. I've got to start making money, you know? So this is my interview with Ed Mann, and Ed's cool, and that's all I got to say. Here it is, Ed Mann.
So, how are you? Glad you could talk to me. This is great. I got a list of questions mile long. I just couldn't quit on the questions. So, hey, where are you at now we're speaking? What part of the country are you in?
I'm in Massachusetts right now.
Massachusetts. Where do you live? Where do you reside?
Well, I've been in Northern California the last couple of years.
I read like Santa Rosa?
Around Santa Rosa, yeah.
Wow. Massachusetts. What are you playing over there? What are you doing?
Actually, I did just play a bunch of gigs with this band, Z3. Great, great band.
Z3, it sounds like
a Zappa trio thing. It's an organ trio, and they play all Zappa.
Really?
But they're really exceptional musicians, these guys, and great improvisers. And
you know, I think I've seen a video on them. The guy plays a B3, and you got a guitar player and a drummer. That's what I saw.
That's B3.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw
so
that.
We did four shows. It was great, you know, adding the mallets and percussion to that. And taking a lot of freedom with the tunes, a ton of freedom, and reinventing them, you know.
Wow.
Really good.
You're as I saw on your Facebook page, you're into the mallet cat, which I love that thing. And I saw you got a launch pad and a chaos pad. I mean, you're half percussionist, half DJ on that setup right there. It looks great.
Yeah, it's fun.
Do you what's your opinion on I've been a percussionist since, you know, junior high, and I just couldn't find a lot of work for it, so you know what I mean? I kind of
Nothing's changed.
Yeah, right.
Well, except no, that's not true, because of drumline and field stuff has completely, you know, I mean, that didn't exist 40 years ago.
Right. Yeah, I remember being on the drum line in high school and dragging a set of, I mean, dragging the marimba across the field. What a nightmare that was.
Yeah, well, that's probably with the choices in instruments, you know, this thing of having to schlep is a major, it's a major thing to think about as you plan your activities in your career, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you can throw that
schlepping that much.
Throw that mallet cat right in the suitcase, and away you go.
That's right. It's a lot. It's fantastic. Especially
How do you feel about that, though? As far as, like, you know, it's all electronic, it's virtual, and going from, you know, I think there's something about hitting a real piece of wood as compared to that. But the benefits I can see, you know, outweigh dragging all that stuff around. But do you kind of miss the old days with tons of stuff around you?
Well, yes and no. I mean, it was a unique and rare situation to be able to have that kind of opportunity, you know.
With Frank. Yeah.
You know, enough people to move stuff like that on a daily basis and not having to be responsible for setting up, which means then I could play well. But if I had to be the one setting it all up, I wouldn't play well after that.
Right.
So, I guess I don't miss it because that was then and this is now. I've been playing on a real vibraphone up until a couple of years ago, and that's great, but then there's limitations in terms of sound and the range of the actual instrument, which I love being able to access from the mallet cat. And ultimately, you know, you just go for the music. And if you're able to get the music out there, then that, for me, seems to override any particular thing about, I wish it was real metal or real wood.
Right.
You know, versus just having triggers. And then plus now I can do pitch bends and I can do ring modulation and do all this crazy stuff with the sound, which is, for a percussionist way of thinking, fantastic. That's what you want. You want to be able to explore as many permutations of the sound as possible.
Right.
So, you know, it's just different, I would say. But I'm thankful for it, because if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be playing very much right now, not live.
And those guys are about the only game in town for electronic percussion. I haven't seen hardly anything else besides that.
Buchla makes this thing, the Marimba Lumina.
Okay.
And that's a very interesting piece. I hear they've worked out some of the bugs now, so it's completely different than the mallet cat, but it's, you know, it makes great sound.
I like how the mallet cat offers the pieces that go in between the notes, so when you miss and you whack the case of it, it doesn't... I see you're not using those. I wouldn't assume you'd miss too many times, but I know I would. And if I'm going to buy one of those things, I'm having all the protection I want, because... You know, you look pretty bad if you're hitting the case.
That's a nice thing, because it's super loud if it hits the case. It's so loud. It's just deafening. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, when I get, you know, I've been threatening to buy one for years, and now I think I've just got to go out and get one. They don't come cheap, but...
You know, I would highly recommend it, and the other reason for that is, for me at least, it really helps in developing creativity.
Right.
And writing, composing. Because it's the tool that goes right in between your imagination and documenting the event, you know,
right.
Recording it in MIDI or in audio, and having that having it hooked up to a laptop and always recording everything you do is really helps a lot in terms of staying, you know, dynamic and vibrant as a composer, as a creative thinker.
Now, speaking of recording everything, now how did you? I know that you first appeared on Live in New York. I think you did some overdubs because I think Ruth Underwood was the she was in the band then.
John Bergamo.
And you, I read that you went in and did some overdubs, and I guess that kind of led to you being in the band later. How'd that happen?
Well, in an indirect way, it led to my being in the band.
Mm-hmm.
Because I met Ruth and I stayed in touch with her, and then Frank called Ruth one night because he couldn't find a second keyboard player, and so Ruth called me because she knew that I knew some interesting people, and I knew Tommy Mars, and I thought, oh yeah, I have just the guy, you know, and then that led to joining the band.
I know that Ruth was with him for, you know, years and years, and then what, she just got tired of being on the road, and that was it, and I was wondering.
So. Yeah, I can't speak for her, but that, I heard something like that.
Well, it's great for you. I mean, how fantastic to work in a...
I know, it's ridiculous. I didn't even... I wasn't really a mallet player when I got the job. I messed around on mallets. It was like a hobby, but I was supporting myself as a drummer and as a percussionist.
Wow.
And so, I mean, it was just unlikely. I don't know, still don't know really why I got the gig, but I did. And
I mean, you got good real fast then, if that's the case, because...
nothing like fear to motivate you.
Now,
I was thinking, this is unbelievable. This is ridiculous. I have Ruth Underwood's job. It's like a bizarre dream, you know, just like so unlikely.
And, I'd have ran the other way, I think. You know, okay, I'm stepping in the footsteps of this lady who, you know, I've heard the end of Inca Roads, and it's like, all right, my hands would break off if I played that fast. You know, so that's, yeah, that'd make me pretty pretty nervous. But, you know, good. Well, hey, you don't still have those Sin drums around, do you? Because if you do, I want to buy them.
I see. I just sold the last ones.
I'm too slow. You know that crazy disco-y sound that I look on eBay all the time. I'm trying to find some. And either they're so broken up that you don't want them or whatever. But, I mean, it's the classic Shake Your Booty sound that it's everywhere on that album. And I just can't get enough of it.
Oh, well, that's great, because when we were doing that, I was saying to myself, I can't believe he's deciding to put this much syndromes everywhere.
Everywhere.
Because on the overdubs, it just, we did it on one tune, and Frank said, okay, now, next tune. So it was just like, okay, another tune, just fill it up with syndromes, because it was unique, and he was having fun with it. But I couldn't, even me at that time, I thought, this is way too much.
Right.
And then I haven't really listened to the release that carefully, but enough to hear him all over the place, so I assume most of it's there. And, it just kind of, it's like a signature for that record, I guess.
That album, though, it never showed up much on any other album that I've ever heard. Not like that, you know, maybe occasionally.
That's just a great example of Frank. You know, if he loves something, he'll go completely overboard with it.
Right.
And that just happened to be the Syndrome's moment.
Wow.
You know, if you wanted to read it, if you wanted to have something like that for yourself, the thing that made the Syndromes great and unique was the fact that you had 8 sliders, active sliders, per drum. So you could change the sweep, you could hit the tone and have it sustaining, and then change the sweep, and then change the LFO, and then speed up the LFO, and do all kinds of stuff real time in order to tailor the sound event. So you could recreate that right now with any laptop program, and then a dedicated controller that gave you 8 faders, like the Akai thing that costs $50 or before, you know, and just assign them to those same parameters, and you could have then effectively the same thing.
That same analog sound. I've tried to recreate it because I have a lot of that stuff here, and I kind of failed. And I mean, I remember seeing the only time I saw people or anybody using it was like Terry Bozzio on Baby Snakes. He was using it, and it's like, yeah, that's the machine, the blue controller thing. But, I'm going to look somewhere on the Internet. I've got to be able to find a syndrome simulator, you know. But hold on just a second. Got a cough there. I got my little cold going. Let me see. I'm going down my list of questions here. So you're in the late 70s, and you start getting these, I assume, charts like the Black Page and whatever. How do you handle that stuff? Was that like, I got it, I can read that, no problem? Or was that just hours and hours of practice with those guys?
It's like most of the stuff doesn't require hours and hours of practice. Most of the stuff just requires playing it a few times to see what it is and then getting it in your ear. But then in every chart, there's always a couple bars that will take days of practice. Going back to it, you know, because you're having to retrain your hands and arms to move in ways that are not natural, and to execute these events. It's like quantum mallet. It's where your mallet is literally in two places at the same time. To execute some of these things.
Yeah. You were jumping back and forth between instruments like crazy anyways there, so you were hopping all around.
Well, that's the thing. That's the reason why, you can't read it. It's not like you could... I can't ever imagine doing a Zappa show and reading it, because it doesn't sound right.
Right.
It has to be committed to memory so you can then get in there and work it like music. Because that jumping around from instrument to instrument, those aren't Frank's ideas. Those are my ideas. And he just told me to put stuff where I thought it worked best.
Wow.
And that I could have freedom and liberty with it if I wanted to harmonize something, if I wanted to edit a part and only play sections of it, or just put the last two notes of a passage over on one instrument, whatever I wanted to do, just do it. And but the only way to do that is to have it in memory, so now, okay, now you can have fun with it.
See, I didn't, and nobody knows that stuff where it's like, you know, is every last note for every last instrument written out, or, yeah, you got that freedom. Well, that's great to know, because that adds a lot to the way you would play it as compared to somebody else who would play it completely different. So that's fantastic.
Yeah, what he would come in with was just simple charts. If it was a melody, a single line melody, everybody got the same melody, and then you start to work with it and you know, work with the raw material.
Hmm. Now, was all that, like on the Baby Snakes film, you got a ton of stuff. Was that yours? Was that Frank's? Who owned all that stuff?
That was mostly mine. The Frank's, the chimes were Frank's, and the big bass drum is Frank's. The vibes at that time were Frank's. Everything else was mine.
Mm-hmm.
And gradually then, by the end, by 88, it was all mine. And by 82, actually, it was all mine. Yeah, 81. I replaced his vibe with my vibe. I just bought a lot of stuff. By 82, we had turned... By the end of 79, or 78, we had turned everything electric. So the gongs... No, the gong pickups happened in 81, but everything except the gong. So the xylophone had pickups on it. The temple blocks had pickups. The cowbells had pickups. Everything had pickups. Piezo elements.
I saw a thing online with Ruth where Frank actually said, I'm going to drill into the marimba here and we're going to add little pickups. And she almost, you know, like, what, really? You're going to drill into these?
Yeah, that's how it's done.
Yeah. That's a big jump. Wow.
It doesn't really affect the sound there, though, because it's the node.
I see.
You know, it's right where the rope passes through. Otherwise it would totally affect the sound. But right there, it's a zero crossing point. So that's how it can be done.
I see. Now, I got halfway decent with two mallets, but holler real players in the world, those four, or, you know,
Well, I don't know, man. Listen to Bobby Hutcherson. That's about as real as you get. And
right.
He's a two mallet player.
Really?
And Milt Jackson, amazing mallet players. You can do certain things with two mallets that you cannot do with four.
Really?
And that has to do with real fast, this is what you hear in Bobby Hutcherson's playing, real fast ornamentation and extended glissandos, controlled glissandos. I call it a glissando, but it's actually more like a like arpeggiations.
Right.
But played like they're an ornament, you know, like it's an afterthought or leading into a main event. And that kind of density, at least for me, I can do that a lot easier with two mallets than four mallets. And I kind of vacillate. I play mostly two mallets. I'll grab four mallets if I need it. But if I don't need it, I'll stay on two, because it's more like drumming. And,
right.
You know, that's where, after all, what is this all? It's drumming.
Right,
you know?
Jerry. Yeah, right, of course. Now, I know that a lot of the guys that play percussion, especially mallet things, I know a lot of the older guys, and I'll throw myself into that, you know, that category, so I'm not offending anybody. But, I mean, are you seeing a lot of really hot, new, younger people coming up playing, you know, especially mallet percussions, or is percussions?
Totally. Yeah, yes. Yeah. I mean, it's like anything else, where there's young players now that just wouldn't have existed when I was young, because the bar hadn't been set that high.
Yeah.
You know, it's like...
It was set that high by you.
Well,
sorry.
I'm one in the string, but if you go back in percussion music to Lou Harrison's Fugue... is so complex rhythmically, not dense in fact, sparse, but so complex rhythmically that there was, when I started playing percussion music in the late 60s, it was generally said that it's the hardest piece to do and that it wasn't necessarily totally possible. But then it became possible because somebody did it.
Right,
and
of course.
And it became normal. And so a lot of people did it. And then it just became standard. When Terry Bozzio played the Black Page on the drums, it was, you know, and when the Black Page happened, it was said, oh, man, that's just, it's impossible. Hmm. But one guy figured it out. It took him half a year, but he figured it out. And then another guy did, and now it's standard. Now everywhere you go, you hear people playing the Black Page, just no problem.
Right.
Because there's something about seeing somebody else do it helps you kind of grok what it's all about and understand, oh, this is how I would approach it, this is how I would play it. So, you know, anyway, yes, to answer your question, though, I see players now, I hear players now that are just, you know, you always have the same response is like, that's amazing, that's incredible. You know, that anybody could do that.
Who's the guy with Dweezil? I've seen him a couple times, but I don't know who that guy is, but pretty amazing and doesn't break a sweat and doesn't blink. Looks like he could be reading a book and playing those.
Yeah,
you
know,
note for note, and not missing a trick. I don't know who that is. I got to find out who he is because
the first guy with Dweezil was Billy Helton.
Billy Helton. I'm writing these down here.
Helton, yeah. Yeah, he's definitely that's an example. You know, when I heard him when he was younger, I realized, wow, that's way ahead of where we were.
Right.
Back in 1974.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I just.
But you know that fortunately in all this, there becomes this other factor that comes to play. If it was purely based on technique, there would be no way to keep up. But fortunately, in the end, it's music that matters, and inside of that, decision making inside of music, and that's why when you hear someone like Emil Richards play, you hear something that you'll only hear through him.
Sure, right.
For him, I was amazing, right at my age, when I was 20 or something, compared to what he was doing at that age. At least he said that. But that's just a normal thing for people to say. It's like the generations keep getting better and better and better. So that may have been technically true at that time. However, I wouldn't say that I can. I mean, Emil is just the best.
Right.
And you listen to Emil play now and you go, there's a master of music, you know. So for all of us, as we're getting older and with our musicianship, that's the thing to remember and the thing to keep in mind is that there's that thing you can only achieve with a lot of years behind bars.
Right, right. Well, of course, there's always the thing, the old Van Halen syndrome, I call it, where, you know, he's, look at that, the guy's amazing, and he invented a bunch of stuff, and nobody else could do that. But now, years later, every, you know, 14-year-old with a guitar could do all that stuff. But only one person invented that stuff, so I'm really... You know, you got to give credit to the person who actually, well, let's say, learned the Black Page first, you know, or anything
totally.
Like that.
I mean,
so.
You know, Bozzio was the first in that way, and on Mallet's Ruth was the first.
Right. And now, do you have a website or something where people can go and check out, because I'm going to talk about your solo albums and things like that. Anyway.
There's nothing right now, but I'm just about to relaunch it all. I took everything down a couple of years ago. I just kind of ducked out of the business for a while. I never stopped playing, but I just needed a break from the business. So I kind of took the website down and took a lot of stuff down a couple of years ago.
Well, all your stuff is available on Amazon, of course, like everything else in the known world is. So if anybody anybody wants your CDs or whatever, that's the place to go. I mean, I looked them all up, all the way from, well, you got Get Up in 88, Perfect World, 91.
Yeah, yeah.
Global Warming, 94. Have No Fear in 97.
Oh, okay.
I like this one, Gong. And it's, that's part one, Sound of Being. You coming out with part two on that one?
That's actually volume one.
Volume one. Yeah.
I have all those recordings ready. I'm going to start releasing stuff again. Yes, so yeah, there'd be a volume two.
Good. Yeah, right. Now, you were in a band with Tommy Mars way back in the early 70s, right?
That's right.
And,
yeah, 72.
What were you guys doing? Just covers or what? What are you?
Well, it was kind of covers. It was more covering like Bartok, but played as a tune.
I see.
Or some Hindemith stuff played in the same way, like a band arrangement, and some a lot of Chick Corea at the time, especially the first Return to Forever was a huge influence on
sure.
it. And some Mahavishnu, and we had some originals, but we were mostly focused on reinventing this other material that we liked.
Right. That's great. I got to get a hold of Tommy. I think I have his phone number, but I need to talk to him on this fine little program too. Because I took a keyboard lesson or two from him out in California.
I see. I
haven't seen him in a decade and a half, so it's like I just need to reconnect with him. Sometimes he's a hard one to get a hold of, but and you've actually gone out and played a little bit with Project Object and Band from Utopia and all those guys.
Yeah, I did. We just got done with Band from Utopia thing that was real successful. It was in Europe, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in November, and it just came off better than we ever could have anticipated.
Wow.
So that seems to have some energy around it. We're going to do more in April and hope to do the United States someday. And then there's a local band here in New England, Z3. I guess we talked about them, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, who else? I do my own things here and there. I'm getting ready to start doing my own thing, which is completely different than any of that stuff.
Hmm.
Again, kind of like jazz, kind of like tribal jazz.
Tribal jazz, wow, cool.
Groove ambient dub jazz thing.
Well, I've been kind of a rock guy for a lot of years, which means, you get your guitar and bass and drums and maybe throw a keyboard in there a little bit, but, to actually have percussion stuff, that's more in the jazz world, and, I don't know what Frank actually considered himself, a rock guy, a composer, a jazz guy? What do you think?
Well, I don't think, he knew that he was a music guy.
Right.
I don't think he ever had any internal dialogue about that. And
just anything.
He was authentic in any genre that he approached.
Right.
You can hear it in the music. He's absolutely an authentic rock guy. And an authentic jazz guy. You listen to the recordings of what he was doing with Grand Wazoo.
Right.
That is amazing, it's so jazz.
Yeah, of course.
It really is, stands up to any of the stuff, it stands up to any of the Thelonious Monk live recordings or any of those great eclectic composers. And the orchestral stuff is absolutely authentic 20th century contemporary orchestral writing, without a doubt.
Yeah, I don't know of too many other people that could pull off writing so many different styles. I mean, I guess you could try, but to have it come out good.
There's nobody. Zappa's an original. He's like, he is to composition what Hendrix is to the electric guitar.
Right, right.
There was no one before him like that. There's been no one since, and unlikely that there will be. Not in Frank's case, not that prolific.
Right.
And has his... is so well-versed in so many styles and can connect the humanity of it all to the musical prowess and, it's...
And make it funny at the same time, which is that, to have a sense of humor when you're trying to do all that really complex stuff, that's amazing. Yeah, no one will ever pull that off and,
also such an interesting electric guitarist, unique.
Oh,
great
yeah.
kind of guitarist, he's certainly in his own category in that way too. There's no one that plays like him and developed that style.
Well, all the guitar players like the high little notes, and he liked the lone ones. A lot of those solos using lower notes than you ever hear a guitar player play. It's just, yeah, there's a style all its own. And, I heard Steve Vai do things that were, you know, fantastic and sound very close to that, but you can tell it's not the same person. Or Dweezil, you know what I mean? It's like, yep, pretty close, but that's a hard one to imitate.
Oh, only Frank thought that way. I mean,
right.
You could imitate it, but...
good luck. Yeah. Try.
Anyway, yeah. He was his own player.
Let's see. I think we can see, Ed and I can hear on the computer that we have 90 seconds left. The computer tells us, so I'm winding down. I think I've plowed through most of the questions that I had, but I can think of a million more, so I'm going to have to do this again with you just because this is really very interesting to me.
Call me back anytime.
I got to call Ed back. I really do. I need to get him back because I've got more questions that I have lined up and have written down. You know, if I ever get to talk to Ed Mann, wait a minute, I did. But if I ever get to talk to him again, I have questions for you, Ed. I'll be looking for you. Let's see. Please subscribe to this channel, this YouTube fine channel, because then when I put up new episodes, you can get to it. TonyTrombo.com also will get you here. And so that's it. We'll see you the next time on the world-famous Talking Zappa. Hey, everybody. It's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now, you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Good night, Austin, Texas, wherever you are.